Good evening. Welcome to the Hudson Library. Do I sound okay?
Yes.
I think actually Jody's on a different frequency, so if you can't hear her, let us know and we'll fix that. Welcome once again. We'll wait for a few more people to come in. Everyone grabs, don't forget there's smoothies in the back, courtesy of Vitamix. There's some refreshments. And then I also want to point out our entrepreneurship series calendar. This series is generously sponsored by the Burton D. Morgan Foundation. We put on a seasons-long program of entrepreneurship events, and this is our first one this fall. So please check that out. I do want to point out next, in a few weeks, on Tuesday, September 27th, local group A. Roy will be talking about succession planning, so don't miss that. That was a topic that many of you had indicated on evaluations was of interest. So we're finally doing that one, so hopefully that will be of interest to all of you. I also want to thank Jody Berg and Becky for being here tonight. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy schedules to talk to our group tonight. It means a lot to us. And providing the delicious smoothies. That's great. So enjoy. Thank you so much. And that's about all I have to say about our programs. I want to introduce Jody Berg, who became the president and CEO of Vitamix in 2009. She is the fourth generation to run the 95-year-old family company. They're based in Olmsted Township. The company is widely recognized for producing the world's finest high-performance blending equipment. Vitamix products are manufactured in Northeast Ohio and sold in over 100 companies. In 2014, Berg received the Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year Award. She recently published the Vitamix Cookbook, 250 Delicious Whole Food Recipes to Make in Your Blender. Please give a warm welcome to Jody Berg.
Good evening, everyone.
Hello.
Is this on? That doesn't sound right. Oh, now. I just took a moment to warm up. Okay, that's probably what will happen with me too. Actually, thank you for the opportunity to be here. It's so exciting to see so many people in one place that are excited about being entrepreneurs and following your passion and living your dreams and all of the things that all of you in this room have in common. So I hope that my story helps you a little bit in your journey. And it's one of those exciting things because any one of you could stand up here and talk about your story and the rest of us would get something from it. So I'm really honored that I'm the one that has the opportunity to be up here. So what I thought I'd do is I'd share a little bit about the Vitamix story, about what we've been through, and then I thought I'd also share a little bit about how I make decisions, because I make decisions in a way, I have a formula that I use to make decisions, and it's one that I use it on my personal life, and I also use it at work. But before I get into that, I wanted to see if you wanted to share with me just a couple thoughts of what would you love to get out of tonight? How many of you are familiar with Vitamix as a company? A lot of you. How many of you have one? So I'm not going to talk about our product tonight very much at all. So if you have any questions, talk to somebody who raised their hand. Or we also have Becky Grimm in the back. If you want to raise your hand, Becky, she is also available afterwards, or I can answer any questions about that. But that's not really what tonight is about. How many of you realize that we were a 95-year-old fourth-generation company? Yeah, not so many. And part of that is the story of where a lot of people think that we're a brand that kind of started in the past 10 years. And so I'll share a little bit of that as well. But share with me, who wants to share some thoughts about what you'd love to hear about this evening? Yes?
How professional chefs have chosen your product, especially as opposed to another product.
Yeah, so how we really got the attention of the professional chefs in the whole culinary world. Oh, good, I hadn't actually incorporated it in there. So if I forget, remind me, and I'll definitely have a couple stories along that line at the end. Yes? Oh, how we go from one generation to the next? I can certainly touch on that as well. Mm-hmm. Yes?
I'm curious about your social media approach.
How we go with social media. Oh, this is a great group. Yeah, I'm gonna, I may be here all night. It's a good thing we have with some refreshments. Yeah?
Yeah, just your overall philosophy in direct marketing.
Okay. Oh, I love direct marketing. That's actually where I came from. So I'm all excited about direct marketing. Good. How do I, time, that's such a relative thing. I'll try to touch on that. Actually, what I'm going to talk about and how I choose to make decisions has been just very helpful in managing my time, and I'll tell you why that is in a little bit. Anything else before we get started? Oh, we got a couple. Go 1, 2, 3, 4, and we're done. Okay, back here.
What makes a successful team?
Okay, yep, that will be touched on. And somebody back here had their hand up? Okay, what's that?
He got my question.
Oh, okay.
Lessons of things that you wish you would have done differently or advice that you give to your younger self?
Oh, we're definitely going to be here all night long if I go there. There's so many things, but I'll try to touch on that as well.
If you ever find the time, how you develop your business internationally?
Ah, yes. Okay, that all sounds good. Well, that gives me a little bit of insights to how to tell the Vitamix story, because there really is so much we can tell and from so many different perspectives. So the Vitamix company, as she mentioned, is 95 years old, and I am fourth generation. It was started by my great-grandfather in 1921. So a lot of you will relate to this. In 1921 was a great recession prior to the Great Depression. So he was a landowner, and similar to what happened to us a few years ago, he found himself upside down and owing a great deal more money than he had in any property value. And so he really had to make a choice to do something different. He decided he was going to go into business for himself. He went out and said, you know, if I'm going to work for myself, I'd like to sell a product that I feel people really need that adds value. Not unlike most entrepreneurs, right? You feel like you have something that adds value. The product that he decided to sell was a can opener. The reason he picked a can opener is because canned goods were coming into the market at that time, but the way people were opening them was with either a knife or a can opener where the blade was unprotected. And people were getting hurt. And when you got hurt back in those days, oftentimes it was, even a cut could be something that was pretty dramatic, right? We don't have the same level of health care and stuff that we had today. So the value of that can opener, even though he was selling a can opener for a whopping 25 cents, which was a lot of money at the time, the value of that can opener far exceeded the price that people were paying, because the other option was for them to possibly get hurt, or their children to get hurt, or not have access to fresh produce. So he started with this concept, the value of the product that I'm going to sell is always going to exceed the price. The second thing he did is he had a product that people didn't understand the value of it right off the bat. And this really goes into direct marketing, the gentleman was asking earlier. People didn't understand the value of that product out of the bat because they didn't really see, well, what's so different about it? The blade is just covered. So he was selling his products through direct marketing, basically. And at that time, it was direct sales. We didn't have direct mail much. I think Sears was maybe doing direct mail, but that was the only one at the time. So he was selling it through direct channels, and he was going to all of these different shows and fairs and demonstrating his product. Those are two things that are very much the same in our organization today. So 95 years later, those are the things that are same. We're not selling can openers anymore. That's different. The reason I share that is when you have an entrepreneurial idea, you don't have to be stuck on one particular product. You can allow your idea to evolve and change and find out what you're really, really good at, and then apply what you're really good at to other things. And that's exactly what my grandfather did. We're also known for creating the first infomercial. So being in the direct marketing business, when the television set was coming out in the mid-1940s, my grandfather was trying to convince my great-grandfather that he really should take his demonstration and put it on this newfangled thing called a television. Well, my great-grandfather was convinced that the television was going to tear apart the fibers of the family, that nobody would want to sit in front of this box for hours on end, and it was just going to go out in the trash bin, so what was the point? Well, apparently my grandfather won the argument, and my great-grandfather would go downtown Cleveland and do his demonstration for half an hour live, and it was aired all over multiple different cities around the United States. So we are known for creating the infomercial, good, bad, ugly, I'll let you decide. Because it certainly has gone different directions over the years, right? But we created the very first one. And we also aired our infomercial live on Saturday nights in New York City. So I'm kind of thinking we started Saturday Night Live. I don't get any credit for that. So then it was also in the early 1950s when, I got to go back. 1936 and 1937, we came to Cleveland to do the Great Lakes Exposition. So my relatives, or my great-grandparents, were from Illinois. They came here for 2 summers. They fell in love with the city of Cleveland. And the one thing that's traveled down through the years is the reason they loved Cleveland is because they thought like it was the hardest working, most dedicated people they'd ever met. And if they were going to have a company anywhere in the U.S., now keep in mind they've traveled everywhere, they absolutely wanted to have it in Cleveland. They packed up their life and they moved it to Cleveland. So I think that speaks volumes for where each and every one of us are choosing to have our businesses, right? Right in a place. And I'd say that today. We have some of the most hardworking, dedicated employees working for us, and you've probably experienced something very similar. So it was about that same time that somebody introduced them to a concept of a blender. Now, one of the values of the can opener was it allowed people to eat healthier. How that had transformed for them, they were still selling the can opener, they were also selling graters, vegetable graters, and they got into the health food business. And so in downtown Cleveland, we opened up a health food store. And somebody introduced them to this blender concept, and for them, it was the aha moment. Because they were already focused on how do we help people eat healthier, somebody bringing them a tool that wasn't being sold to help people eat healthier, it was sold to bars and restaurants, they were able to connect the dots in a way that nobody else was. So we were one of the first companies to say, you know what? If every person in the U.S. had a blender in their kitchen and they were using it to eat differently, we could make their lives so much easier, plus they could eat a lot healthier. So that was where that was the aha for them. So we added blenders into our product line back in the early 1940s, and we've been selling blenders ever since. So fast forward quite a few decades. I came back to Vitamix after I'd been there when I was in high school for a couple years, and I went out and did my own thing, was having a ball, swear I would never work in the family business. Anyone like that? Yes, I'd never do this. Are you crazy? But I did. So in 1997, I decided to come back because we were heading up an international division, and I wanted to take the company global. So I had some international experience, not a lot of business experience, but I traveled a lot, and I had some. I worked for the Ritz-Carlton. I was in charge of their quality program, and I had enough that I was willing to take an extremely low paycheck, and they were willing to pay me an extremely low amount to see if I could figure that out, right? So I came back to Vitamix in 1997 and was able to kind of establish us internationally. Well, in 2002, 2003, the gentleman that was in our household division was convinced beyond a shadow of a doubt that there was no future with Vitamix and health. So as much as my father, who was the president at the time, tried to convince him otherwise, he just really didn't see the vision, and they had to part ways. And my dad, the typical family business, says, can you help? I need you to oversee this division. So I stepped into household, and I literally just fell in love with our household products. We sell in the commercial industry and the household industry. I fell in love with the household products, and I started to pay attention to what was going on in the world. And it was in 2004, 2005, where I was trying to get market research to say what was happening in the understanding of health, and there wasn't a lot out there. But people that I'd always ask, what's your eating lifestyle like? If somebody said that they were vegan or vegetarian, I would ask them why. Up until that time, most people that answered the question, they said it's because it's for the animals. I want to take care of the animals. I want to protect them. I don't want them to be harmed. Right about that time, people started to say it's because it's better for me. It's helping me with my health. And I don't know exactly the year that the China study came out. I don't know, but other books started to come out about that same time too. And this is one of the things when you're an entrepreneur. If you know what you want better than anyone else, if you have a vision for something, you will pay attention to signs out there that nobody else is looking at. We had a research company come a couple of years ago, and they were showing us all this data, and they said all these trends started to shift. The trends about how people looked at their health, how people thought about their diet and what they ate, how people owned the relationship with their doctor, the books people, all this stuff changed. And I said, I'm guessing it was about 2004. They put up the slides and it was 2004. So there was definitely a shift in the wind, but there wasn't a marketing company out there that could have validated that for me at the time. But I knew it was happening. And I knew that this was an opportunity for our organization, who's been relatively small for generations, and we would sell direct, and we'd have to take everybody from zero understanding of whole food health all the way up to, okay, I get how a blender would help me do that. And I realized that the world was changing, and people were getting there for other ways, and it didn't require us to spend all the money to take them up that curve. So I started to get the organization ready. This is what happened starting in 2008. That's our sales chart. We grew over 5 times as an organization, just year over year, hiring 300, 400 people at a time. It was just incredible, amazing growth. That's the background of the story that I want to share. This is what I had to change within the organization in order to get us ready for that type of growth. I had to literally change everything. We were a small, family-owned, direct marketing organization, and I knew that we needed to be a company that was going to be where people were doing their homework. We needed to be where people were buying, because people were going to get there whether we were going to be on the shelf or not. So we took it from a direct marketing company to a retail organization. We took it from a dozen or so countries to now we're in 141 different countries around the world. And in order to do that, everything about the organization had to change. So what I want to talk about is, how did I make the decisions? It's a whole nother presentation if you want to hear how we changed each one of those things. And at some point, I do speak about that on occasion. So if you're interested in that, stay tuned and look for another opportunity. But I'm not going to actually talk about each one of those tonight. What I want to talk about is how I made those decisions. So we often hear the saying, dance as if no one is watching, right? Often, we're trained with that saying as kids. Well, dance as if no one is watching. Why? Because if somehow we think that nobody's paying attention to us, that gives us the freedom to do what we feel we want to do. We can just cut loose, right? And we can just be free. I want to flip that for you and say, I want you to dance because the world is watching. Why is that? If you have a vision, if you have something that is, it's your personal passion, it's something that you feel like you are on the planet for, it's something that you feel you can achieve, and the possibilities are endless, then if you choose to dance as if no one's watching, you're missing out, because your vision, your dream is probably so big that you're not going to be able to do it alone. You want everyone to be watching, and you want everyone to be get just as excited about it as you are, right? So that they can help you bring that vision to happen. So this presentation is all about dance because the world is watching. You want them to watch, and you want to get them on board. So the first part of that dance is determine your destiny. And what does that mean? That means in your gut, the reason you are choosing to be an entrepreneur, the reason you are choosing to branch out and do something is because it means something to you. A lot of people think all of a sudden, because nobody else is instantly understanding what they're talking about or what the vision is, that maybe there's something wrong with the vision. That's not usually the case. It's that you're onto something. And you may need to refine it. You may need to talk to people to figure out how to articulate it in a way that people can understand what your vision is. But you absolutely don't want to lose sight of your passion. So on top of, this goes back to the time question, so on top of running the company, I also have decided to go back to Case and get my PhD. So I'm getting my PhD. And the reason I'm getting it is because what I'm studying is the intrinsic motivation that comes from having a personal purpose in life. Now, I'm choosing to do that because I had multiple things in my lifetime, a couple of times where I almost lost my life. And so I have a very clear understanding of why I'm on this planet. And I don't take a moment for granted because I don't know when those moments are going to end, right? And I just had a reminder of that about 6 weeks ago when my daughter and I were in the car and we were hit by somebody who was looking down and didn't realize she had a red light. We walked away from the accident, but 3 people came up to us and said, I can't believe you guys are even alive because of the car. So if you haven't had one of those moments yourself, you can live vicariously through me. That's fine. But use that experience or even that mental moment to realize that if you have a personal passion that's really digging in and kind of in your heart, don't wait another moment to really figure out how to make that happen and really understand what that is. So that's what the D is all about. So for Vitamix, we have a vision statement. What is our D? So how I needed to get people through this very significant transformational change was I had to make sure that my D for the organization was in line with what the organization's D was, right? So I already had a relatively large organization. I had a couple hundred people to work with here. So what we did is we asked the organization, we had customers and employees, we had vendors and suppliers, we had owners, we all came together in a big room for I think it was 2.5 days, and we used a process called appreciative inquiry. Appreciative inquiry is something was developed by a professor down at Case Western Reserve University. So if it's something you're interested in, you can get more information about it there. But it's a process to figure out what is really good, what's really right that already exists that you want more of. So we were raised to think that we have to fix problems. Appreciative inquiry says figure out what's already good and how do you make more of that. So in that process, this group of people came up with this particular vision: to improve the vitality of people's lives and to liberate the world from conventional food and beverage preparation boundaries. Aside from being a little difficult to say, it's got a lot of meat in it, right? There's a lot in that statement. So this didn't come from me, but because I love this organization and the culture and I was a part of it, I'm really, really good with this vision, and I probably could have written it. This is so much in my own heart, I probably could have said the same thing. But the beauty of it is I didn't. The employees of Vitamix are the ones that came up with it, the customers, the suppliers. So that's why I know that this vision is something that's going to resonate with people. Remember I said test drive your vision, help other people figure out how to put it into words? Well, go with the people that you trust the most, that understand you, and have them help you figure out what that is. Go to the people that you're going to need buy-in from and have them help you develop what that statement is. So this is what our vision statement is. The next thing I developed was our business objectives. I wanted to be really, really clear about what we're doing and where we're going, right? So our business objectives, the first one is to be a strong, profitable organization. That's always a good thing to make sure you're really clear about. And we want to be rooted in our values, but we don't want to be rooted in our values just for no reason. We want to do it for the benefit of, and we listed all of our stakeholders. So how do we use information like this? I carry it around, and all of our employees carry it around in a card. We call it our inspiration card. I have no pockets, or else I'd have one on me right now. So we have an inspiration card, and we use it as a compass to remind us where we're going. We also use it as a decision-making tool. So when we have to make decisions as a group, we pull out the card and say, wait a minute, are we representing the benefit? Is there a benefit in this for our customers? Is there also a benefit for the employees? Is there also a benefit for the owners? If we're not balancing out all of these stakeholders, then chances are we're probably not making the best recommendation for our decision. And we'll keep churning on it until we can figure out what decision is best for the organization when it aligns with all those things. The beauty of this is, now that I have this all written into our what we call our inspiration card, is I know that all these elements were developed by our employees. So when I'm making a decision and all the employees aren't around, if I'm making a decision that matches what's on this card, that's aligned with what's on this card, I know that I'm representing them. And I know that their voice is in the room. But wait, there's more. When they're making decisions, and if they're using this card and all the information on it in order to make the decisions, if they're making a decision that's aligned with our vision, our mission, our values, and the other things on this card, I know that my voice is in the room. And I don't have to manage everything. I don't have to micromanage. I don't have to check every decision. As long as these decisions are aligned, then now I have released an entire force of hundreds of people out there making decisions all day long without somebody overlooking every decision that we make. That's the only way that we got through this hyper-growth situation that we did a couple years ago. So, and this is our mission, and it's a little bit more specific. The vision is why do we do what we do, and our mission is what are we actually going to do? In our case, it's to design and develop and produce the world's best performing blending solutions. Blending solutions. As long as people are working within that, they can make decisions all day long. Somebody wants to come to me and say, we made a great decision. We're going to start selling coffee makers. I'm able to say, whoa, wait a minute. That's outside of what this mission statement is. That one I'm going to call you on. But you want to make decisions in here? Make those decisions all day long. So the next one, the A stands for align your world. So now you know what your vision is. You know where you're going. You've got the people that are a part of that vision, that are part of your world, they're understanding what the why is and where you're going. The second one is to align your world around it. Now, I mentioned that I use this to make personal decisions as well. So my personal D is I want to give people the opportunity to find their wings, and I want to help them fly. That's my personal D. Anyone, and I have this amazing opportunity in my current role as President and CEO to help all of our employees and our customers and all the amazing people in the community. If there's a way that I can help people discover their wings and help you figure out how to fly, then I'm achieving my D, right? So then you have the A, which is align your world around that. And this goes back to the time question, right? So how is it that I can be a mom of two teenage daughters and run a company and go back and get my PhD? And how come I'd love the opportunity to come out and speak in Hudson in an evening when I could be at home? The reason that that's okay is because everything that I do is so aligned with giving people the opportunity to find their wings and fly. When I spend time with my daughters, I'm spending time helping them discover who they are. I'm spending time helping them develop into the person that they want to be. So that time that I'm spending with them is really good, rock solid time. And it's time that we've created memories and we have moments. And when I'm going back and I'm pursuing my PhD in a topic that I'm trying to do right here at Vitamix, and I've seen it happen, and I want to help my daughters develop that. So all of the different elements of my world are very aligned. So much so that when I went back to get my PhD, or I should say I was thinking about it, I talked to my family about it, talked to my daughters, talked to my husband. I said, this is what I'm thinking about. This is why I'd like to do it. I said, but it's a big investment for all of us. The entire family is going to have to basically go through this process together. And I gave him some time to think about it. We talked about it again. And then I went silent, and I didn't say anything for a while. And then one night, I finally got down on my knees. Now, I'll pray a lot, but I often don't get actually on my knees. That night, I physically got on my knees. And I said, God, I'm feeling like this is something I want. And I don't want to put me first in this decision. It's too big, and the impact on my family is going to be too great. I said, can you somehow let me know if this is the right decision for this family versus just something that I want? I went into my daughter's room. She was 11 at the time. And I tucked her in. And as I was walking towards the door, I sat down, had this wonderful conversation. We talked about several things, but nothing to do with me going back to school. I got to her door, and as my hand was on the handle, she says, Mom, I've been thinking about this. I think you need to go get your PhD. Not 25 minutes after I was on my knees. It doesn't matter to me whether you believe or not believe in God. This is just personal and the timing of. And I stood there and I froze. And I said, sweetheart, what made you say that? Just out of curiosity. She says, I've been thinking a lot about it, and this is something that you want to do, and I don't want you to ever have regrets. And I know how important that is to not have regrets. And so I think this is something that not only you should do it, but we as a family, we will help you. And I came back over and I says, well, you know, it probably means I won't be at your volleyball games as much, and I won't be home as much, and I'm already gone a lot. It'll be more. And she goes, Mom, I know. We'll help you. We can do this together. So it's that aligning your world to make sure that the decisions that you're making, is everything pointing you in the direction that you want to go? And I think one of the reasons why it was okay for my family to support me on this is because I have more energy when I'm following my personal passions. Every single one of us does. It's not unique to me. If you're doing something that is so important to you personally, then you're going to get energy out of it versus put energy into it. At the end of the day, you're going to have more energy. You're going to be happier. You're going to be more fulfilled. You're going to be this person that your daughters and your sons and your family members and your employees and your friends want to be around, because you are the best that you can possibly be in that state of mind. So that's what aligning your world is all about. So one of the ways that we align our world at Vitamix is I'm determined to create a culture where people are self-inspired because their personal purpose in life is something that they're able to achieve while they're at Vitamix. Just because you have a personal purpose doesn't mean you have to be the entrepreneur, and it doesn't mean you have to run the company. For instance, I have a chief operating officer who one of the things he would love to achieve in his lifetime is to create an iconic brand. Okay. All right? He's not saying, I want to improve the vitality of people's lives and liberate the world from conventional food and beverage preparation boundaries. And that's not what he's saying. He says, I want to create an iconic brand. And guess what? You come to an organization that has a great culture and a wonderful product and wants to go global. We have the everything he needs to create an iconic brand. I don't know how to create an iconic brand. That's not my upbringing. That's not my strength. That's his strength. The beauty of that is, in my role, I need to make sure that every single obstacle that might be in his way, that I get it out. Because he is driven to figure out how to make sure that we never compromise the opportunity to be given being an iconic brand. For our customers to say, we do believe you're iconic. We know that we can't make that happen, but we can certainly make sure we never do anything to keep it from happening. And that's what he's working on really hard. Amongst other things, he's amazingly talented. I have my chief financial officer is actually my cousin. And one of the things that she wants to achieve in her lifetime is to take the organization into the next generation. Okay, you do that. I don't have to worry about that. Why? Because she's not doing that for anyone else but her. She's doing it because that's what she wants to do. So she's not gonna set herself up for failure. She's not gonna take any decisions lightly when it comes to going down that path because this is so meaningful to her. She wants to succeed from inside her body, right? Inside her heart, she wants to succeed. So surround yourself with people that have a vision or a personal purpose that by them achieving their personal purpose, one, you don't have to, right? But two, whatever that personal purpose is, if it helps you drive your vision, that's where you have alignment. I can focus on improving the vitality of people's lives. Lori can focus on getting us into the next generation. Tony can focus on helping make us become an iconic brand and take us global. And now we're off doing what we do best. We don't have to do the checks and balances thing all the time. So how do we do that? It really is about the level of involvement that somebody has in being able to make those decisions and then how much ownership they have in the decision that they're making. You probably can't read this, but way on the bottom left, it says decide and announce, meaning that's you're making the decision, you're just telling people what you're doing. All the way up to where this did end, it was delegate with constraints, meaning you just tell people what they could do, and then you can tell people, okay, you can make that decision, why don't you make that decision, why don't you make that decision? I've taken it a step further, and I say that if you create the space for people to function within, if you help people figure out what the ultimate vision is, and you find people that can align because they have their own personal passion, then you can empower people through alignment and then just get out of the way. And that's how we went through some pretty incredible growth. The N stands for two things, but you know, two N's, it doesn't spell dance right, so we'll just put the two down there. Network, create a network of people. You don't have to do this alone, right? There's so many people out there that care for you deeply and they want to help you be successful. Figure out who they are. But the other side of the coin is, there's a lot of people out there that don't care about you and don't really want you to be successful. Figure out who they are. And align your world around the ones that want to help you be successful. And that whole alignment thing, it's some of those decisions are not easy to make. Sometimes you have to walk away from things that you know are not going to help you get to your destination. You know, oftentimes, speaking of the alignment thing again, because it's really such an important one, people spend more time planning their two-week vacations than they do their life. And somehow we get about halfway through our life and we can't imagine why it is we are where we are. How did I get here? Why did I only achieve this? It's kind of called the midlife crisis. It's because we didn't do a whole lot of planning. But we'll plan our two-week vacation. We know where we're going. We know who's going with us. We usually know how we're going to get there. And if you're a scrapbooker, you know exactly what pictures you're going to take because you're going to create the memories. Because for the next multiple decades, your kids are going to remember that vacation the way you took the pictures, right? But we're very strategic about our vacations. So this is making sure that we're planning out our life the same way. Well, part of that planning is, who is it that you can network with? So everyone that's attending this program, that with all these different sessions on how to be an entrepreneur, these are probably amazing people to network with if you're not already networking with each other. But find those people. Find the people that have done it already and ask them. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. The second N is a safety net. And that one's really, really important because you are willing to do so much more when you feel safe, right? So the trapeze artist doesn't start out without a safety net. They might be crazy enough to do it when they're actually live with that one, but they're not going to start out that way. Why would we start out that way, right? So build your safety net, figure out what that is, but make sure you have a safety net in place so that you can go out and be the best that you can possibly be and you're not afraid of failing. Now that makes a lot of sense to us as individuals, but let me tell you how you do that for your organization, the people that work for you as well. Because wouldn't it be amazing to have an entire organization of people who feel that they can go out and do the absolute best that they can? They can actually push the limits a little bit because they know that it's going to be okay to fail. Because if you want to truly be innovative and just rock your world and create products and new things, that you have to be out there on the cutting edge. You can't play it too safe all the time. So how we did that is part of that inspiration card I shared with you is we have a set of values. And we have 5 values. And how we created those values is we interviewed 98% of our employees and we said, what is it that you value most about this organization that you absolutely do not want us to change? We're going to go through some pretty rapid growth and I want to know, what do you want to hang on to? I was basically saying, what do you want is your lifeline? Because I need to be able to change absolutely everything else in your world. And they came back. The leadership wasn't involved, but they came back, and this group from CASE and our employees, after they interviewed everyone, they put together these 5 themes, and they came up with these 5 values. Whatever values you and your organization have, there's no right or wrong answer. Our 5 values are not the values. In fact, that might be my next slide. Nope, guiding principles, there you are. Our values are not the values. You can have whatever values make sense for your organization. The important thing is they are the values that the people that work for you share, or the people that you want to bring together share. That's what's really important. Why is this a safety net? Because when you think about the friends that you are the closest with, the people that you feel the safest around, oftentimes it can be family, oftentimes it can be friends. The reason you feel the safest with them is probably because you share values, not because you think alike. Not because you enjoy doing the same thing. It's because you share certain values. Those are the ones you feel safest with, right? So if you imagine having an organization where this is where all the values that our employees said they had at the time, and every single employee that I've hired since then, we've interviewed them to find out whether these values resonate inside them, right? If this is what's important to them. And if it is, then I know when they come to work for Vitamix, they're going to feel safe. They're going to be able to spread their wings, and they're going to be able to fly, and they're going to be able to do things because they're not spending all their energy trying to make the person next to them who values something different happy. They're not trying to satisfy a boss who's got very different values than they do. They're not trying to be somebody that somebody else is saying you ought to be. They get to be the person they want to be because all of the things that already matter to them also matter to everyone else around them. So if you take nothing else out of this presentation tonight, please think about values and realize how powerful it is to have them articulated and to be able to put a group of people together that share the same values. Having the same values does not mean you think alike. But having the same values absolutely means that if you disagree, you have a common place that you can go to work through that difficult conversation. So you're not looking for people that think alike, look alike, do things alike, none of that. You want a lot of diversity. You want people to think very differently than you. But if they value the same thing that you value, then you're not going to be in this conflict of not, it's my opinion versus yours, because you actually value the same thing, and that's really more important. So somebody was asking about succession, and I can't go into a lot of succession without without a lot more time. But one thing that's really important is to find out somebody who's going to have the same values as you and allow them to make the decisions that they need to make. So if you got another generation, another next generation family member, figure out if you value the same thing. If you value the same thing, and possibly they share your vision or they're comfortable with your vision, but most important is the values. Then you can step back and you can allow them to make decisions because you know that they're going to make decisions that aren't going to cross into a space that's you're feeling is untouchable because it's something that you value. Does that make sense? So it's just something when you're thinking about succession planning. Yeah.
The family item on the top, does that refer to your family or the company as family?
You know, that was the first question we asked when they presented this to us. Is that the Barnard family or is that as a company family? They said both. We said, we think it's really most important that we have a family culture, people support each other. And they said, well, you know, that's true, but we also love the fact that this is owned by a family, and because it's a family-owned company, that you guys are going to make decisions differently than if it was publicly held. So they wanted both in there. So the next one is to take care of yourself. And the interesting thing about taking care of yourself is we so often think, especially as entrepreneurs, that we have to bring this home, right? We have to bring it home. And once we do, everything will be wonderful. I have to tell you, you have to take care of yourself, and it's a journey. It's not an end destination. You know, this always reminds me of when you're in an airplane and the flight attendant says, you know, put the oxygen mask on yourself first. Why is that? Because you do nobody any good passed out in the aisle, right? So make sure that you have your oxygen. Make sure that you're eating well. Make sure that you're exercising. Make sure that you don't get lost in your own personal passion such that you don't get to live out your personal passion. So this is a tough one, and I put it in here, not just because I needed a C, actually. I put it in here. The words came, the steps came first, and then I had to figure out what word makes sense with that. But it's the care for yourself first because you want to be in it for the long haul. Right? You really want to be in it for the long haul. And you will help others better when you are at your best. So don't get lost in your own passions. And the last one, the E, stands for embrace and enjoy the process. So often we get so, as I just mentioned before, it's all about getting to the end. You don't realize that there's all these amazing celebrations in the process. And make sure you enjoy those and enjoy them with your employees as well. So just a little bit about where we're at now. I told you about where we were, and I told you about the growth. So this is just a sampling of some of the blending products that we have. You noticed in our vision that it was still very focused on blending solutions, right? We are the high-performance blending company in the world at the moment. We're setting the bar. We're figuring out what's coming next. We're the innovators. We're driving the whole industry, which is a really, really exciting place to be. A little intimidating. A lot of hard work, but it's really an exciting place to be. But who would have thought that you could be a global organization selling blenders? Not a lot of people, except for the people who care more about health and more about blending than anyone else on the planet. So whatever your idea is, don't think that it just because others tell you there's no way as a blending company you will ever be able to be global and you'll be able to change an entire industry. 10 years ago, people weren't having green smoothies for breakfast. People weren't having spinach and kale for breakfast and for lunch. It just wasn't even in people's concepts, right? There was a couple of people that had opened smoothie chains, but they were cranking through blending equipment, because we didn't actually get into the commercial business until the 1990s. So they were cranking through their blenders, and there was no way they could go and create a chain around the United States, let alone go global with it. So it was our organization that, because we care so much about blending, that we were able to push the envelope, change the way you thought about blending, and we literally created the entire high-performance blending industry. I'm not saying that because I want somebody to say, oh, wow, good for you. No, the reason I'm saying it is because you can too. Don't let that stop you. Think big. Go make your D big. It doesn't have to be because somebody else says it's doable. So I think most of this I've probably said. Oh, somebody asked about the chefs around the globe. So it's the chefs are just an amazingly creative, philanthropic group of people. I don't know if there's any chefs in the room, but what an incredible, and I don't know why that particular industry attracts people that care so deeply about other people and are so giving. But they also know their stuff, right? So we had chefs coming to us and saying, you know, you have this incredible blender that's used in the household market. We don't have anything we can use in our kitchens. So part of how we got into the commercial industry is because we said, okay, let's help you figure out what would you need in your kitchen. We developed one for the chefs, and we've just kept this relationship with them, not saying that we know how to be experts in the culinary world. The chefs do. We've allowed the chefs to be the ones to help us figure out what we need to do with our equipment to give them the tool that they need. And now we're in a wonderful position where we've had chefs say that where it used to be the chefs coveted their knives, now they coveted their Vitamix blenders. Right? I knew we kind of had gotten there when probably about 10 years ago, maybe it wasn't that long, but I was in New York City at a restaurant, WD-40, I think, was the name of it? No, 40, Wiley DeFray's restaurant. Was it WD? It was an address, WD, whatever his address was. And I think he's moved since then. But so I was visiting with Wiley DeFray, and he is in the gastro, what do they call it? Gastro, anyone know what Wiley DeFray with? He just takes food and does amazing different things with it. Like he'll take carrots and turn it into something completely different that have the flavor of carrots. There's a name for this, and it'll come back to me in a second. But he said, my blenders, my Vitamix blenders, I come in the morning, we turn the lights on, we turn the Vitamixes on. At the end of the day, we turn the Vitamixes off and the lights off in that order every day. He used them for every single item on his menu. And then I went downstairs and I was talking to his pastry chef and I was asking him about his Vitamix. And while I was talking to him, he brought the Vitamix out and he set it down and he took his cloth out and he was polishing it. And he was wiping the fingerprints and somebody came in and said, oh, can I use it? He goes, oh, not on your life. You're not using it. And that's when I realized that, you know what, we've created something that we're not the only ones that have such an incredible passion for it. So when we talk about aligning your world, we have aligned our world with the chefs around the world because they get it and they're just as passionate about high performance blending as we are. Let's see, this is just a sampling of some of the ways that we distribute our product on the household side. We do mostly now through a lot of retail channels. We still do demonstration, as you see in the middle up there. We don't do direct mail at the moment, but we have a very, very strong web presence, and we have a strong social media presence to draw people in through either our website or our channels and or through all of our retail channels. The one thing about social media, and I wish I'd actually brought a video that give you a sampling of it, is the way we look at it with social media, our goal is to get people actually talking. And talking about any subject that has to do with whole food, with health, with diet change, with successfully changing your lifestyle, whatever those topics are, because we've gotten to the point that if somebody's talking about that, somebody else will bring Vitamix into the conversation. So we don't have to start conversations about Vitamix. We simply have to start conversations about topics that somebody else is going to implant Vitamix into. So one of the things that we've been working on with social media is you heard several years ago, you got to get, you want the customers talking to you. You don't want to be just talking to your customers. Well, we took it to the next level and said, we want the customers talking to us, obviously. But from a social media perspective, I don't care if they talk to me at all from a social media perspective. I want them to talk to each other. And I want these global communities out there. I want to start the communities. I want to fuel the communities. I want to give them more good, authentic, real information. I want to help the communities. And then I'm going to want those communities to talk to each other about Vitamix. So we watch what people say. We watch how often they speak about us. But we try not to be the one interjecting our brand into the conversation. Just some information on who we are today with Consumer Reports. Consumer Reports was interesting as well because for many, many years, we didn't score very high in Consumer Reports because they said, and then you could get a really, really, really expensive blender and it's Vitamix. And finally, we just kept calling them, no, we're not interested. And we said, wait, but you're putting us in this category because we look like a blender, but you're not doing your tests in a way that you're really benefiting your customers. Eventually, we got them to listen to us. They completely transformed how they evaluate blending equipment. And since then, Vitamix has been the number one blender in Consumer Reports because now they understand, well, what can you do? If you can't make hot soup, if you can't make frozen treats from frozen ingredients to a blended creamy sorbet, if you can't make peanut butter, if you can't make all the things that Vitamix can make, well, okay, you can make some things, but you're really not being able to make it all. So we were able to help them change how they thought about blending. That was not easy. This is an example just of some of the chains or some of the categories that we're in on the commercial side and how much of market share we have. So a sample of our commercial customers. It's not all about healthy. Sometimes it's about blending food really, really well. So those are the five steps that I use when I make decisions. And I use that dance to make decisions within our organization. I use the dance to make decisions at home. I use that dance to just make sure, am I aligned? Do I have the destiny? Is it clear? Do I know where I'm going? Do I know where my destiny is? Do I have a clear vision? Do I have a clear vision for this project? Do I have a clear vision for the organization? Do I have a clear vision for, it could be big, it could be small. And then align my world around it. What decisions do I need to make even if I know I don't want to make them? Here's the beauty of the align your world and if it's a difficult decision. If you conscientiously are aligning your world around your D, you may choose to do something that's not going to help you get there, but you're doing it by choice. You're doing it conscientiously, and you're aware of your decision. And then you're choosing to do it or you're not choosing to do it. That's the beauty of it. You may still choose to do something, but you know that you're conscientiously not going to be getting towards your goal. That's all it is. It's just an awareness, right? So create your network of people. Make sure you have a safety net. Take care of yourself. Embrace and enjoy the process. But most importantly, choose to dance. Thank you. So I was trying to talk very fast because I wanted to leave some time for questions. So if you have questions, we have a microphone so everyone can hear your question. Yeah, we have one back here, and then we have a second question, the gal up here in the pink.
Thank you very much. What is your biggest business challenge as a company?
My biggest business challenge? Well, at the moment, it's a bunch of competitors that came out of nowhere and said, we're just like Vitamix, but cheaper, when they really aren't. So at the moment, that's one of our biggest challenges. Because they literally took our message and how we were communicating our product, and they say exactly the same thing. And that was when we realized, oh, wait a minute, then we're not telling the whole story. If somebody else can take our message and say it's the same thing but cheaper, then we're not telling the whole story. So one of our biggest challenges is figure out, well, how do you continuously give a little bit more of the story? So the interesting thing about our particular product is most people know it for smoothies, and a lot of people are now making smoothies for breakfast. The Vitamix also allows you to make an incredible hot soup out of just straight produce. You can make ice cream, you can make baby food, and the most amazing peanut butter you've ever had in your entire life from just peanuts and no other ingredients. That's a little bit too much to just, every time we go out with our message, share. So we've been trying to figure out, well, how do you share a little bit more of it? How do you help people realize that there's more? So that's one of our big challenges at the moment. Yeah, but the list is long. I can tell you more later if you're interested. Yeah.
Over here. My question is, I have two questions.
Yeah.
One question is, I'm a big proponent of Vitamix, and anytime I'm talking to people about health food, the Vitamix always comes because I see that not only the Eastern vegetarian concept, but the smoothies and the hot soups. I was just talking to my sister-in-law, and she has a severe arthritis, and she has severe osteoporosis. And she says, baby, I'm really having a hard time opening the lid. And so my request for, you know, would be that mm-hmm. if you make, you know, some kind of
Okay, so what she's sharing is she has a sister who has osteoporosis, and it's very difficult to open some of her lids. The reason it's difficult to open her lids is because we do allow you to make hot soup, and so our lids actually seal. So when it does get hot, the steam is going to come and vent out the top, but it doesn't blow the lid off your blender. So what I would do is I would have her call 1-800-VITAMIX, talk to customer service. Depending on which model she has, some of our models, the lids are easier to open than others because some of them just have different ways that you open them. So I'd certainly have her give us a call, and they can walk through which one she has and which one might be the easiest for her to use. And then it may also be where we have some where it's easier to use, but you can't blend hot liquids in it. They'll help her figure it out. Yeah. So absolutely, 1-800-VITAMIX, ask customer service. They will answer that question for her and make sure that she's got the one that's got the easiest lid for her to open.
Okay. And my second question is, from a professional perspective, what has your organization done as far as diversity is concerned?
So the second question is, what has our organization done as far as diversity?
How diverse is your workforce?
Mm-hmm. We are probably, from a diversity of male-female, we're about 50%. We actually have more women in our organization than men, so we're a little north of the 50%. We are located in Olmsted Township, which is not a very diverse part of the greater Cleveland area. So when we look, you know, I don't know what the actual breakdown would be as far as minorities within the organization. It's probably something, I just haven't looked at that one in a while. But as far as recruiting and attracting, we're certainly always trying. We're kind of struggling with the whole Olmsted Township. So we're not as diverse as we'd like to be. One of the reasons why I would love us to be more diverse is because we're a global company and we're talking to cultures all over the world. And the more difference we have in how we think about things and different perspectives, it just makes you a better organization. So be as absolutely diverse as you possibly can. Yes?
Yeah, what sales strategy has... great talk, by the way.
Thank you.
What sales strategy has worked best for you, and which sales strategy do you think it's in your mind that will even work better?
So that's a really, 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 really big question. But I'll try to give one piece of the answer, a little slice of the pie. So if you go back to our vision to improve the vitality of people's lives, and there's second half of Liberate the World Convention, which basically changed the way people think about food. But the first part is improve the vitality of people's lives. Every time we take that out of the equation, we are not as successful. And one of the reasons that is the case, because people are always trying, we'll try this, we'll try this, we'll try this. It doesn't mean it has to be the entire message, but it's got to be part of the message. And the reason why is because I'm going to have you raise your hands, if you personally or you have a family member or a friend that is struggling with a health-related illness, that could be something to do with the heart, or it could be cancer-related, or it could be obesity, or it could be, high cholesterol, it probably has to do with heart. Raise your hand. Just raise your hand if you know somebody that's in your life that is struggling with something that's food-related. Right? Look around. This is personal, right? This affects just about every single person on the planet. Every one of us has to eat, and every one of us is affected by the food that we eat. So by making, and that going back to that personal passion, right? If you can connect your message, and we found the same thing, with the thing that people are really most personally, it's personal to them, you'll have more success. And that's exactly what we found. So every time we take that out of the formula, we are not quite as successful. Yes, do people who are foodies love to cook? Is everything we make in the Vitamix healthy? No, it's not. Not even in my house, right? One of my favorite things to do is after I make peanut butter, I put in some ice cream, and if my kids are home, I'll add some chocolate, and I'll whip it up, and they get themselves a peanut butter chocolate milkshake, right? It helps clean the machine, and it makes them really happy. But so not everything's healthy, but it can be. And then it just, it kind of speaks to people's hearts. Yes, up here, and then we got a question up here.
Me?
Yes, right. Please, sir.
How many employees do you have, and what is your succession planning? Since you're a family-owned business, it seems as though you might prefer and be biased and prejudiced toward family members. What opportunities are there for others in the company as the years go by?
Oh, that is a fabulous question. One, between employees and our sales reps who work very, very closely with us, we have 1,300 people, north of 1,300. And as far as succession, the next person to run Vitamix probably will not be a family member, because we don't have a family member that's what they're interested in and or they're ready. So we are preparing to make sure that from a family's perspective, what we care about are the values, what we care about is the vision and the mission. And if we can align the organization, we'll find somebody who cares about those same things, and it'll probably be run by somebody who's not a family member. Will there be a fifth generation family member that at some point wants to and or is prepared to? Possibly. We're doing what we can to help prepare them. But if they get the opportunity to run Vitamix, that's great. If they get the opportunity to run something else because we've invested in them, that's great too. Does that answer the question?
Sure. You left, but you came back.
Yep.
So is that opportunity a possibility going forward?
Yes. It is. At the moment, I'm not sure we have anyone that's the right experience in order to do that. So I think the next person probably won't be a family member, but it doesn't mean that a family member might not come back at some point. Yeah, and we're very open about that within the organization, too. Yeah, I think there's a question up here, and then we're going to go, somebody had a hand back there, and then up here. Yes?
You mentioned that you had a group from CASE that came in and worked with the organization to develop the values.
Yes.
Did you have the talent internally to develop your vision and mission? And if not, how did you go to the outside to get that help? But also, in developing the values, missions, and vision, how did you ensure that those were aligned globally, since you're now a global company?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. So as far as the resources, we used people from CASE for multiple appreciative inquiry sessions. And for the guiding principles, which I kind of went through rather quickly, it was one of the slides I had up here, and it's the things that we passionately believe in more than anything. We had Dr. David Cooperreiter himself, the father of appreciative inquiry, come and help us with that. But we had other people that are trained in appreciative inquiry come in and kind of facilitate the process for us. So I highly recommend that if you're going to do appreciative inquiry process, bring somebody in. Oftentimes, like we did with our values, it could be a student project, and it doesn't cost anything to have the students come in. But I highly recommend it, or somebody in your organization can be changed. And your second question was?
How did you ensure that the values, mission, and mission was aligned globally?
We would check, because we, one, have some global, we have global customers, we have global employees, and we have different agencies and stuff that we work with, and we run it past them. One of the things that we found, once you create it, doesn't mean it's like locked in stone and never changes, right? So one of the things we're talking about right now is improve the vitality of people's lives. When we created that vision statement, vitality was an up-and-coming word on a global level. Well, just recently, we had one of our agencies look at it, and because we're saying, you know what, I'm not sure vitality is resonating the way we thought it was going to resonate. And they were able to say, well, no, I'm not sure it is either. So that's one of the words that we're exploring to figure out, is there a different word that kind of took the place of vitality? So it doesn't mean you change the essence of who you are, but you do need to kind of refresh things and make sure that it still makes sense. So that's a really good point. Thank you for bringing it up. We had a hand that was raised kind of in the middle back here, and then we have the gal up here in the white sweater. Nope, no hand now? Okay, we can, that gentleman.
I have a lot on the board, so just wondering how you promote Vitamix within your own organization, if you afford to use it, if you work with them to say how you implement this in your life, and ways to make your own life better.
So it's really, we're lucky that we have a product that is so much fun. If you've become a Vitamix employee, you get your own Vitamix within 90 days of being an employee. And then we have a Blending 101 class that all employees can attend. And then we just have sessions where...
I'm
I mean, we have access to anybody learning how to use it. And what we really want to encourage people to use it. We have also put together a, as part of our health benefits program, some of you might have experience with this, but we have a third party where, based on how you achieve certain metrics, we as an organization will pay our employees deductibles. So by paying their deductible and by meeting these credits or by meeting these measurements or metrics, there's an encouragement for them to get healthier, because the healthier you get, the better you are to meet those metrics and the more you're going to have your deductible covered. So we've put things in place to encourage behaviors of people becoming healthier. And then we'll have lunch and learn sessions where we talk about how you, the value of food overall, and then sometimes we'll demonstrate recipes and just get everyone engaged in it. Yeah. And then I'm sorry, right here, and then we'll go here.
Yeah, yes. Hi, Jody. So a couple things. You know, I see the success of culture and the success of business with the design of leadership. So mm-hmm. I highly encourage you. I just really enjoyed your talk.
Oh, thank you.
The second thing, when you think about global products, and having been involved in developing global products, there's a lot of localization in certain parts mm-hmm. of the world.
Mm-hmm. So she's asking the question, because we're a global company, oftentimes when you are global, you still want to feel local. So how are you a global company that feels local in all the different markets that we're in? And how do we make it feel local when 100% of our products are manufactured right here in Northeast Ohio and then being shipped into those countries? Okay? So the making it feel local, there's the marketing and the messages and all the support material, and then there's also making it local with the product. So we have multiple different SKUs of products that are different container sizes, different, every single one of our products will perform the same as far as the end result, but how you get to that end result might be different. Your container size might be different, as I mentioned. You might have dials, you might have timers, you might have a variable speed, you might interact with the machine different. There might be more of a tactile experience. So when we go into a country, we first do an assessment of the country to find out what types of our products are the best fit. If it's a very specific fit, we may not necessarily be able to engineer or change it specifically, but we find the ones that are the best fit. And then we'll make sure that the support materials, that we work with local chefs to develop the recipes, with local resources to develop the recipe books and put it together, the messaging, and help us with our websites, that type of thing. So we really do want to be the Vitamix where people think, oh, that must be an Italian product, or that must be a Japanese product. We want to really make them feel that who they are really matters. So that's how we do it. Okay, question over here, and then we have a question over there. Yes.
Thank you very much for the inspiration. I have a passion for the environment and sustainability. Mm-hmm. So my question for you is sustainability a part of your company? And you have specific programs that benefit the company and the environment. Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting. She's asking about sustainability. Sustainability has been part of our culture before sustainability was a word that people even became popular, right? It just was. So one, we create a piece of equipment that should, we have a 7-year warranty on it, but it could last you decades. We've had people that have had their Vitamix machine for over 50 years. Our goal is to not see Vitamix machines in a landfill someplace. So that's our, but it wasn't because we wanted to be sustainable. It's because it was the right thing to do. And we wanted to create a product that people could have, right? So the other thing we do is if somebody returns a product, if they've bought a product at Costco and they go home and they have a spousal regret, which happens, then the machine gets sent back. we have a process where we call it our certified recondition process. We'll recondition the unit and make it such that we can then sell that unit again to somebody at a lower price, because now it's being sold as certified recondition unit instead of a brand new machine. So even machines are coming back to us, we don't want them to go in the landfill. We have a lot of sustainable practices as far as the products that we use. So the containers, if a container needs to can't be sold again, it can be recycled, which of course it does. One of the things I think that is, it's kind of a fun story, is it was probably 20 years ago we decided that in as many cases as possible, we wanted to use reusable containers to have our components shipped back and forth to us. So we had to go out and create them because 15 years ago, there weren't a lot of suppliers that were going to do that. So we have certain components, all the ones that we can, where, for instance, our motors come to us, we take the motors out, and we ship the crates back, and we've been using the exact same ones for over 15 years. So when you think about all of the cardboard boxes that haven't had to be used. Now, are we completely sustainable? Unfortunately, absolutely not. We aren't. And we don't look at it as a particular formula to say, does it make sense to do this or that? We look at it and say, you know, if it's the right thing to do, and it's possible for us as an organization to do it, then let's figure out how to make that happen. I think, you were the question next, right? Okay, and then we're going to go here, and then we're going to go back there. Okay.
What brought you to the conscious decision to concentrate on the world's greatest mixer and not diversify into related products like, four-wheel drive can opener? also, my other question is dealing with mass discounters like Amazon putting pressure on your pricing and margins?
So the first question, now I've lost the first question after you asked me the second one. So I'll answer the second one first, and then you're going to remind me of the first one. What do mass discounters like the Amazons and probably the Walmarts of the world, how much challenging is that? Well, we choose who we want to work with and who we don't. Now, not everyone has the luxury of doing that, and I totally understand that. But when you're in high-performance blending, we have the opportunity to do that. One of the things in the way we work with Amazon is, on Amazon, their biggest selling product is our certified reconditioned units. So we have the opportunity to sell those and discount them because it's not the same unit that you're going to get in other places. So we just have a very large channel management program that helps us navigate through all of those different channels. And certain ones, we just simply choose not to sell through, like Walmart. And what was your first question?
Why did you decide to stay just with the best mixer and not go in other areas?
That's a great question because, one, there's so much potential there. Two, if every single household in the United States had a blender on their counter and were using it, can you imagine how much healthier of a place this world would be? Is there a possibility that we could actually change the direction of food-related diseases in our lifetime? Is there a possibility that we could change the way people think about food so that the generations coming after us could eat healthier? There's so much potential there still that the thought of going into something else and distracting us from that vision is something that I'm not prepared for us to do. If somebody can convince me that there's still not so much more potential out there in changing the way the world thinks about food and making the world healthier through high-performance blending, then, okay, now I will entertain other things. But they haven't been able to convince me that yet because the understanding of health and whole food continues to grow. People owning their own health and realizing that you do not have to be a victim of your parents' ailments is continuing to grow. People are owning their own health in a way that they've never owned it before. We have the potential to live a full life much longer than what the medical solutions is going to be able to provide for us. And there's more and more research coming out about the impact that what we put into our bodies, how it affects how we feel. You know, it's interesting. We know that our cars need gasoline to run, right? How many of you put apple juice what was the one I'm thinking of, loaded with caffeine? All the kids are drinking it. Yeah, Monster and all this thing. You don't put that in your car because it would give you more energy. Therefore, it's got to work with your car. No, you put gasoline in your car. And therefore, your car runs. Yet we put all this stuff in our bodies it doesn't help us run. It's just that we are such an amazing machine that we're able to run for quite a long time on stuff that has no space in our body, and we don't even know what to do with it. Yeah. So nobody's convinced me of that yet. And I think we're going to go here. Yes.
Yeah, I have two questions.
Okay.
The first one is, who came up with the name Vitamix?
It was my grandmother's father, even though it was my grandfather's father who started the company. So my great-grandfather when my grandfather got married, my two great-grandfathers became really close friends. And he was very ill, my great-grandfather on my grandmother's side, my maternal great-grandfather, maybe that's how I say it. So he is very ill with intestinal problems. And they collectively as a family wanted to see if they could make him better. And all of the medical solutions at the time were doing nothing. So they decided to go with Whole Foods way back when. That was in the early 30s. And it was through that and he came up with the name Vitamix when the blender first came out. And we stuck with it. And then we made it our company name because we just loved it. So she said, what do you do in the interview process to find out whether a potential employee's values mirror our values? Do not ask them what they value, especially if you publicize your values. Pretty much guarantee what kind of answer you're going to get. But if you ask them questions about what matters more to you than anything in the world, and just listen to how they answer the question, ask them about their family. So tell me about your family. And if they say, oh, I got two kids, they're off in college, it's great, but they're gone now. Or if they say, oh, my daughter just went off to college, and it's been really hard having her gone, but it's been great because she's getting a chance to explore. I mean, depending on how they answer the question, you can assess, do they really value family or do they not value family? You know, integrity, we ask when you, what was a time when you had to make a decision that was really, really difficult to make because it was different than what somebody else was telling you to make. I didn't talk about values. I didn't talk about integrity. I just said, tell me about a time when you had to make a decision that was very difficult for you to make. And depending on how they answer that question, you can get at where their level of integrity is. So come up with questions that don't specifically speak to the value that you're trying to get information about, but they will tell you a story that in that story or in that information, you'll be able to assess whether they have that value. Yeah. And then we had a question back here. Yes?
Do you sell only blenders or vitamins, if not vitamins?
So we only sell blending equipment and blending solutions, I should say. So we have a couple other products. For instance, we're working on one now, which is a scale. And that scale, you can put your Vitamix container on the scale and pull up the recipe. And it will tell you when you have enough grapes. You don't have to measure your grapes. You can just put it in there, and it says, oh, that's enough grapes. Now you need to put some spinach in. Whoop, that's enough spinach. Now you put this in. So we're coming up with other products that help with the whole blending solution category, but it's all about blending.
How about the calories?
Yeah. What's that?
Does it tell the calories?
Whoops, that's enough calories. Yeah, it does. It will tell you the number of calories in what you're. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. So she's asking if we explore partnerships with organizations like Weight Watchers and others, and how do we explore those types of partnerships. So there's sponsorships out there where if you give people a whole bunch of money, they will talk about your product. We avoid most of those like the plague. The reason being is because people see through that, and they know what those organizations are after a while, and they know, well, the only reason they're saying it is because you paid them a lot of money to do that. So we try to do a much more organic, authentic approach. Now, it works for us because Vitamix happens to be a product that people get very, very passionate about. So that whole concept in through social media, as I mentioned, of trying just to give people the opportunity to talk, if somebody is a very influential individual and we know that they'll do a lot of talking, we may give them a Vitamix in appreciation for them talking about us, but we're not really into spending a lot of money with one individual. So certain organizations that are open to, for instance, it's not Weight Watchers, but there's another one that we worked with where they wanted their customers to be successful, and the way that they knew they could be successful is if they had a good blender. So we worked with them to make sure that their particular customers could get blending equipment and they knew how to get it and special pricing and stuff possibly for them. But we don't spend a lot of money to say just kind of promote our product. I don't know if that answered your question.
It did.
Okay, good, thank you. Yes.
You've been in 140 countries.
Yeah.
What process do you use to maintain that culture and the boundaries that you talk about since you're so diverse, especially 13 months before?
I thought you were going to ask me to name them. Thank God you didn't ask me to name 141 of them. So we're sold in 141 countries. Some of them we sell direct, meaning we have companies that we've set up in those different countries. And in cases like that, we very much know the culture because we've hired people in those countries that are from that. A lot of those countries we sell through distributors. And so we will defer to our distributor and make sure that our distributor is... We're learning from our distributor, and we're giving them the freedom to personalize it in the way that makes the most sense for that particular culture. And in some of those countries, we don't have a presence, but they'll sell directly, they'll buy directly from us online, and we can ship it into that country. That's probably the one that's the most distance as far as us speaking the way they want to be spoken to. So it depends on the country.
Is there a process of training that they go through, that you fully consistently go through to maintain that?
Yes, very much so. When we have a long onboarding process, every time somebody goes over to spend time with those employees, they will do more training on that performance that inspires card I was telling you about, our culture, our core, we call it. We do training that way when they come here. We do training on it, and we just use it and everything. So I think you're touching on something that's very interesting. So when we were growing, we were all in one building over in Olmsted Township, and we got to the point where we were just bursting at the seams, and we had to move out and split up. And I was terrified of splitting the company into two different locations. I thought, what's going to happen to our culture? So we ended up moving an operations center to Strongsville, Ohio. And to this day, and it's been multiple years now that we've been there, I walk into Morgan Court, and I think the culture over there is almost stronger than a corporate. Because that group of people, the values that we talk about, it's not imposed values. It's values that resonates inside every employee. And now, are there times that we hired a couple people that maybe we missed? Sure, there's going to be a few of them. But for the most part, our employees will share all those values. So they are creating the culture at Morgan Court based on things that they value, which happen to be the same things that we as an organization value. And I realized, you know what, I had to not worry so much about whether we were influencing the culture. I had to allow, I've done the right things. I'm hiring people that share those values. I'm sharing a vision that people are excited about. I'm allowing them to do things that match their own personal purpose of what they want to achieve in life. And I needed to allow, to step back and allow them to create that culture. And it's still a beautiful culture. So when you go into a different country, some of that same thing happens. Yeah. Yes?
I think someone had asked you if you could look back on something to tell your younger self.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe something along those lines.
You know, it's funny. I didn't include the slide in here, but sometimes when I do this presentation on dance, I show the picture of what I looked like in high school. And and then I have a picture of a little bit closer to what I look like now. But the point of that slide is when I was in high school, I weighed less than 100 pounds. I think I was maybe north of 95. I was so shy. I was I just felt like everyone else was so smart and had something to say. And I tried to speak, and nobody heard me speak anyway. So I'm thinking, obviously, I've got nothing important to say. Nobody can hear me speak. So I was just probably could have been voted as most likely to just vanish into nowhere. So if I could say something to myself, it would be that lesson that I learned when I was laying there and the doctor said to my mom, at this point, we're really hoping to get her out alive. That, I changed. I heard that and I went, whoa, I haven't even gotten started yet. What do you mean? It can't possibly be we're hoping to get her out alive. That changed me. I would tell myself, you as a human being are precious because of who you are. You are made the way you're made. You're going to go through the experience that you're going to go through, the good, the bad, the ugly, whatever it is, it has made you. And you are this beautiful human being that follow your dreams, follow your passion, make sure you are heard, and dance as if the world is watching. And I would say, choose to dance. Thank you very much, everybody.